Well, hey guys, you have been asking for some time now for me to do a video on Sculptra, so that's what you're getting today. We're gonna be talking all about Sculptra. It is a filler. I'm gonna be going over what it's indicated for, what you might expect with it, the pros and cons of Sculptra, and I'm gonna be discussing how it differs from other types of filler on the market. If you are new here, welcome. My name is Andrea. I'm a board certified dermatologist. I post skincare content here on YouTube pretty regularly. If that is of interest to you, definitely subscribe, hit the bell notification that lets you know when my videos go live. The term filler is kind of a catch-all term used to describe a variety of gel-like substances that can be injected to enhance bone structure and to restore lost volume. Now, the majority of fillers that come to mind when people are talking about fillers that are FDA approved are going to be hyaluronic acid-based fillers. Hyaluronic acid is a hydrating substance. It's naturally found in the body and it attracts water. I've got a lot of videos talking about hyaluronic acid fillers, the complications. I will link some of those down below in the description box. But there's another category classified as biostimulatory fillers, meaning they kind of stimulate your body to naturally produce its own volume, and namely that's going to be collagen. Biostimulatory fillers include Radius, Belafil, and Sculptra, which is what we're going to be covering in today's video. Now, you've probably heard a lot more buzz around Sculptra lately because it recently has gotten some new FDA indications, namely for wrinkles and fine lines. But Sculptra has been around for a long time, and a lot of dermatologists have been using it for a long time off-label for wrinkles and fine lines for some time now, but it is now FDA approved for that indication. Prior to that, it has been FDA approved since 2004 for the treatment of fat loss in the face of HIV patients undergoing HIV treatments. So one adverse effect of certain HIV medications is that it can cause fat loss in the face. That's actually quite disfiguring. I wanna say around 2009, it got FDA approval for deeper contours like the nasolabial folds. So what the heck is Sculptra? Sculptra is poly-L-lactic acid. It's this sticky polymer that is actually the same compound as what is found in dissolvable sutures. They put sutures underneath the skin that later dissolve. Same substance as many of those types of sutures. Sculptra differs from hyaluronic acid fillers in that, in contrast to hyaluronic acid fillers, which provide an almost instant filling effect, the filling that happens with Sculptra is much different. It stimulates your body's ability to produce collagen, so it's a lot more gradual in onset, but the end result is longer lasting fullness because it's actual collagen that your body is making as opposed to just temporary volume replacement. Fibroblasts are cells that make collagen, so this stimulates them to make more collagen. Now, as you can imagine, that is not an instant effect. It takes some time. It occurs gradually over 6 to 12 weeks. As those fibroblasts start to be stimulated to make collagen over the following 6 to 12 weeks, you start to subtly and gradually notice an improvement in skin tone. Some people refer to it as the Sculptra glow. You can imagine as you get new healthy collagen being naturally made, you start to have more luminous appearing skin. You also have softening of wrinkles and a gradual improvement in volume. You may be wondering, okay, so you're injecting Sculptra and eventually the body starts making its own collagen again as a result. But what happens to that Sculptra that was injected? Well, it gradually dissolves over the following 9 to 24 months into carbon dioxide and water. With Sculptra, you need at least 3 treatments spaced at least 3 weeks apart, and it takes time to see results. So it's not the kind of thing that you go in, you get the injection, and then people are like, oh, whoa, did you just get filler? How much does it cost? Like with any cosmetic procedure, it's going to vary depending on where you live, but it's going to range anywhere from $850 to $2,000. The pharmaceutical company that makes Sculptra is Galderma, same company that makes Differin gel, and same company that makes Cetaphil. Same company that makes Cilantra, and they have recently kind of reformulated Sculptra for a better product. Basically, they have made it so that it can be more dilute, and that's advantageous because previously Sculptra has always been a very difficult product to work with. I have used it myself, not on myself, but I have used it for patients, and it's very, very sticky. The older formulation, your needle would clog a lot, and the other annoying thing about Sculptra was that you had to make it up 24 hours in advance to let it kind of marinate. And that was a pain because, as you can imagine, a patient might come in, you discuss a treatment plan, come to the conclusion that Sculptra is the best option for them. And then they have to come back because you don't have the Sculptra made up. You've got to, you know, make it up and let it sit for 24 hours. So this is nice because now a patient comes in, you decide that Sculptra is the best treatment for them, you know, the right approach. You can just go ahead and dilute the new formula and it's ready to go. So that's an advantage. And because the newer formulation has tweaked the dilution, it is a lot more fluid. The needles don't clog as readily. And there's less risk of a side effect that can happen with Sculptra, which is the formation of nodules, which nobody wants. So that's the gist of what Sculptra is. It's different from hyaluronic acid filler in that it actually stimulates your body's cells to make collagen. And it's considered semi-permanent. Hyaluronic acid filler is not permanent, as you guys know. You've got to go back in and get another injection, you know, around 10 months in order to maintain the fullness. Whereas with Sculptra, you do have to get multiple injections, but once you get them, you get that gradual onset of volume restoration. It's your body's own collagen. So it's semi-permanent in a sense. The Sculptra itself is not permanent. It dissolves, but the end result is more permanent and sustained because it's your body's own collagen. There is a lot of variability though from person to person in terms of the new collagen synthesis from Sculptra injections. Not everyone's fibroblasts respond as robustly, so there can be some variability in terms of the outcomes that you get. Not everybody is somebody who responds well and gets less than ideal results, and it is an expensive treatment. In contrast to hyaluronic acid, let's go over the pros of Sculptra, why it's advantageous. First of all, it's a lot more discreet in that you get it and it's a gradual onset, so it's not as obvious. If you want to have volume restoration and improvement in facial volume, but not have that like all at once, oh my God, you got filler. It's a lot more discreet. And it's semi-permanent in contrast to hyaluronic acid filler. So your body is going to make some collagen and that's going to be more long lasting. Now the substance itself will dissolve, but in contrast to hyaluronic acid filler, this is considered semi-permanent. The other advantage of Sculptra over hyaluronic acid filler is that it's less likely that you're going to get that overfilled look. You know, a lot of people who get really into getting fillers, they can tend to have that sort of doughy, puffy look after a while that's very unnatural. With Sculptra, it's a lot more natural. You're not gonna get that puffy, overfilled, doughy look. And in contrast to hyaluronic acid filler, after the series of injections, you're gonna get lasting results that last for years, in contrast to a hyaluronic acid filler where you're going to have repeat injections every 10 months. Those are the pros. What about the cons? The number one con in my mind is that Sculptra, in contrast to hyaluronic acid, it's not reversible. So a hyaluronic acid filler, you can go in and dissolve with hyaluronidase. There's nothing really that can dissolve Sculptra. So if you decide that you don't like the results or you develop an adverse effect like nodules, well, there's not a whole lot that can be done. In the case of nodules, then those can be removed surgically, but it's challenging and not everyone is a great surgical candidate. So it's a lot, you know, it's a big commitment, I would say, up front. And you have to have a lot of confidence in the injector and the technique. And so it's definitely not something to just kind of decide on a whim. It is something that is irreversible. The other con for some people is that you're certainly not going to get instant results or instant gratification. For some people, they want something more instant. They're really, really bothered by the volume loss in their face. It's really affecting them emotionally. They may not be willing to have that gradual delayed onset of benefit. I say it's not instant, but you might likely notice some swelling in the first 48 hours. So you may think that that's what it's gonna look like. That's just temporary swelling. It's not something that you're gonna appreciate for many weeks to come. You also have to commit to having repeat injections. 3 injections about every 3 to 4 weeks. The other somewhat annoying thing about Sculptra is that you have to spend some time massaging it in after the injection, about 5 minutes of massage, which, you know, may be bothersome to you. And the reason for that is to allow for more even distribution and prevent kind of clumping. The maximum volume enhancement that you will see typically is around 12 to 24 weeks after the final injection. So again, a bit of a delayed gratification there. As with any injectable, of course, it can be painful to have the injection. Now there is lidocaine in the injection, which helps with that, but there can be pain, there can be bruising. And a more worrisome, I guess, side effect, of course, is going to be the formation of nodules. Now, there are a variety of approaches and techniques to minimize the risk of nodule formation. The injector, of course, can make sure that the Sculptra is dilute, and this newer formulation allows for that. They also can inject smaller volumes. Certain injection techniques minimize the risk of nodule formation. So these things can really reduce that risk substantially. The other con with Sculptra is that there's actually no guarantee that you're going to get results. The degree of neocollagenesis or new collagen formation, it varies a lot from person to person. Some people just don't respond to Sculptra. You know, their fibroblasts are just like, whatever, and don't make the collagen to the same extent. And so they're less happy. You know, they're gonna get underwhelming results. And it's expensive, and there's nothing that can guarantee that you're going to get the results that you want with it. So those are the pros and cons of Sculptra in comparison to hyaluronic acid. Now that we've got FDA approval of the use of Sculptra for wrinkles and fine lines, I'm sure it will be something that is more commonly in the aesthetic dermatology practice arsenal, or plastic surgery arsenal in terms of volume restoration tools, but it has been around a lot longer than you might think. It's not anything really new. What are some other things that this might be helpful for? You're probably thinking about it in terms of volume restoration in the face, but it's also used to treat volume loss in the backs of the hands. There is a lot of interest in using Sculptra for the improvement of cellulite. As you can imagine, the dimpling that you see with cellulite, it really bothers people cosmetically. You can imagine how stimulating the skin to produce collagen can kind of smooth out some of that dimpling in the skin and improve the contour of like the upper thighs where you have cellulite. And then for patients who have undergone Sculptra, I mentioned, you know, you kind of get a more radiant glow. It's called the Sculptra glow as your body starts making more collagen. But in a lot of patients who happen to have indented acne scars, you can imagine we observe that those scars start to smooth out. So there is definitely interest in Sculptra for acne scars for sure. The other thing that people are intrigued with when it comes to Sculptra is this something that someone, say, in their 30s might want to try for a preventative? It's not as though we have studies saying that if you get Sculptra in certain areas in your 30s, then later on in life you will have fewer wrinkles. Of course, you guys know the majority of the reason why we get wrinkles that we can control is going to be the amount of sun exposure, but genetics and hormones and things definitely play a role. And with age, we start to make less collagen. So by boosting up collagen production earlier on in life with Sculptra, would that have a preventative effect? It's definitely something that people ask about. But the majority of people who may be pursuing this are those who have visible volume loss, sagging, and are looking for volume restoration, skin tightening, and an overall more radiant glow. But it is not anything that you can go back on, so it is a big commitment. It's definitely not something that you can just kind of decide last minute that you want to do. I would definitely talk to your aesthetic practitioner, dermatologist, plastic surgeon, and, you know, maybe discuss with them if this is really right for you, because like I said, there's nothing that can be done really to reverse it, like with hyaluronic acid fillers. So that is Sculptra, something that can be used to stimulate your body to make more collagen, firming up the skin, improving volume, and smoothing out wrinkles and fine lines. I hope you guys enjoyed this video. Let us know in the comments though, if you have had Sculptra, what your results were, did you get a good response in terms of collagen production? Share in the comments your experience, but I hope you all enjoyed this video. On the end slate, I'm going to put my video on filler gone wrong, where I cover common complications of filler. But if you like this video, give it a thumbs up, share it with your friends, and as always, don't forget, sunscreen and subscribe. I'll talk to you guys tomorrow. Bye.